From the iconic Sopwith Camel to the legendary Spitfire and all the way to the cutting-edge F-35, combat aviation's finest designs have been marked by their flawless symmetry. So when Blohm and Voss rolled out a peculiar creation, a bomber with a single engine at its center and a pod on the side housing the pilot, observer, and rear gunner, many doubted it would ever get off the ground. Yet appearances can be deceiving. While this plane looked lopsided, the forces at play were remarkably balanced. The asymmetric weight countered the asymmetric lift and propeller force, making this bird more stable than many of its single-engine predecessors. This oddball aircraft had what it took to shake up the industry. Designed as a bomber that would look like a fighter, it gave its crew unparalleled visibility from the pod and its gunner the best view to take down pursuing fighters, a stark contrast to the cramped and restricted sightlines of typical single-engine cockpits. When the prototype demonstrated impressive range and operational capability, the design was poised to revolutionize bombers in World War II. However, skepticism abounded at the Reichsluftfahrt Ministerium, with resistance from high-ranking officials, including Hermann Göring himself. To prove its worth, the Blohm and Voss team would need to put their creation through a series of high-stakes tests, pushing the aircraft to its absolute limits. The engineers at Blohm and Voss stood firmly behind their unorthodox design, ready to fight tooth and nail to see their vision soar into combat service. Germany was bracing for war, and Adolf Hitler had grand plans to turn the Luftwaffe into the world's fearsome aerial combat force. This ambition ignited a whirlwind of development and bold experimentation, thrusting Germany to the forefront of aircraft innovation. By 1937, the German Air Ministry, known as the Reichsluftfahrt Ministerium, called for a single-engine, three-seater aircraft designed for short-range reconnaissance and observation. One essential requirement stood out: the plane needed to offer excellent visibility. Major German aircraft manufacturers, Arado and Focke Wulf, scrambled to answer the call. Meanwhile, Richard Vogt, the maverick head of Hamburger Flugzeugbau, backed by their parent company Blohm and Voss, had a daring idea. At the time, Hamburger Flugzeugbau was best known for its flying boats and float planes, which were essential to the Luftwaffe's operations. The Air Ministry seemed set to hand the contract to Arado for their R-198, but it turned out to be a colossal flop, leading to its abandonment. With Arado out, Focke Wulf snagged the contract with their FW-189 Uhu. This twin-boom design was a marvel, but needed two small engines, not the single-engine setup specified. Undeterred by the lack of an invitation, Vogt proposed a radical asymmetrical design. This out-of-the-box thinking aimed to achieve the desired single-engine configuration with an off-center cockpit, essentially developing a light bomber with a twist. Vogt's audacious design wasn't just about meeting specifications. It was about pushing the boundaries of aviation and showcasing Germany's relentless pursuit of aerial dominance on the eve of World War II. Before the idea of jet planes could even be imagined, many designers, including Walter Blohm and his company, believed the military need for flying boats would transition to commercial use after the war. At the time, the world lacked the extensive network of large, well-equipped airports needed to support land-based aircraft. Flying boats had a unique advantage. They could land on water, which was readily available in many parts of the world, including remote and underdeveloped regions. The vision was that seaplanes would eventually replace passenger ferries and boat lines, offering a new mode of transport across continents and countries. Flying boats were designed with larger hulls, allowing them to carry more fuel, passengers, and cargo over longer distances compared to many land-based aircraft of the period. Water landings were also perceived as safer in the event of an emergency. In line with this vision, Blohm and Voss always designed their aircraft with potential commercial applications in mind, despite their limited resources. As World War II began, aircraft production rapidly evolved from wood and canvas biplanes to sleek metal monoplanes. The industry embraced a conventional design approach for both military and civilian aircraft. These planes typically featured a contoured fuselage tapering at the rear with an engine mounted in front of the cockpit. Straight-edged wings were positioned forward on the airframe, complemented by vertical fins at the tail. Few designers dared to innovate beyond these conventions despite inherent drawbacks. Traditional cockpit designs often left crews with poor visibility above and behind the wings and engine. The centralized engine placement caused propeller wash to aggressively impact the rudders, forcing pilots to constantly counteract this effect. The powerful engines needed to rotate large propellers, skewed flight to one side due to torque, necessitating constant pilot corrections. Drawing inspiration from the stability and visibility requirements of the flying boat design, Vogt envisioned an aircraft that could overcome these limitations. This led to the creation of the Blohm Voss BV-141, an asymmetrical aircraft that broke away from conventional design. The BV-141's unique layout, with its crew and observer compartment positioned off-center from the main fuselage, was aimed at maximizing visibility. This concept paralleled the design of flying boats, where the cockpit and observation areas were designed to give pilots and navigators an unobstructed view thanks to their high-wing design. The Blohm Voss BV-141 was a standout aircraft for its unique and unconventional design. The plane featured a plexiglass glazed gondola on the starboard side, offering unparalleled visibility. Plexiglass was the brand name for a highly resistant type of acrylic plastic, chemically known as polymethyl methacrylate. This material made the cockpit significantly more transparent and afforded better visibility than that of the FW-189, thanks to the extensive glass paneling. Its other specifications made it an up-and-coming solution for the Luftwaffe. It promised a speed of approximately 229 miles per hour, a reach and altitude of over 32,810 feet, and a range of about 745 miles. Its wingspan would span 57 feet and be operated with a crew of three, consisting of a pilot, observer, and rear gunner. At first glance, the aircraft's asymmetrical weight distribution seemed like it would cause instability. However, the weight was evenly supported by lift, maintaining balance in flight. The original BV-141 design included a symmetrical tailplane, but this was modified for the 141B variant. The starboard tailplane was removed to improve the rear gunner's field of fire. The first design featured a pair of slim booms, one slightly offset towards the port side of the center line, housing the power plant and tail unit. The other boom, offset towards the starboard side, contained the plexiglass crew nacelle, which was the centerpiece of the design. These cylindrical structures were connected by a single long straight-edged wing with clipped tips, mounted towards the front in a standard monoplane configuration. The tail unit or empennage included a rounded, highly swept tailplane and a horizontal tailplane positioned towards the port side. This initial prototype was powered by a conventional radial piston engine with a three-blade propeller system, driven by a single BMW 801A engine producing 1,560 horsepower. The aircraft achieved a maximum speed of 272 miles per hour, could reach an altitude of 31,810 feet, and had a range of 1,181 miles, surpassing both the speed and range that had been previously protected. The final design of the BV-141 featured a single tail system with an asymmetrical arrangement. This configuration effectively distributed the aircraft's weight and resolved the handling problems that plagued previous aircraft designs. Blohm Voss wanted to push their creation as the ultimate light bomber design, but they were well aware that their unique pod design also made the BV-141 very attractive as a reconnaissance aircraft. Engineers at Blohm Voss knew the BV-141 would be one of the most unique planes of the World War II era. Embracing Germany's trend of novel military developments, they recognized that placing the engine in the nose and the cockpit to the side would offer superior aerodynamics compared to conventional arrangements. This approach demonstrated that an asymmetrical airframe could match, if not surpass, the performance and handling of symmetric models. Walter Blohm imagined the BV-141 bewildering enemies with its unconventional shape, potentially leading them to mistake it for a fighter rather than a bomber. From the start of development in 1938, Blohm Voss aimed to create a plane capable of challenging the formidable Hurricane Mk1, a mainstay of Allied forces on the Western Front. As passionate as their asymmetrical aircraft designs were, Blohm and Voss's BV-141 presented dire flaws that would limit its potential. Several critical issues were overlooked until the prototypes were entirely produced. One major problem was the rudder, which suffered from constant drag. Additionally, while the cockpit placement improved aerodynamics, it left the crew more vulnerable. The extended wing was lengthened to maintain balance and accommodate the additional weight of machine guns and crew, which was crucial for the aircraft's stability. Three prototypes of the BV-141 were completed for testing, along with an evaluation batch of five Version A models. German pilot and Luftwaffe General Ernst Udet reportedly backed the production. At the same time, Goering and other high-ranking officials opposed such a radical design. The issue was resolved through grueling tests designed to push the asymmetrical warplane to its absolute limits. Its range, maneuverability, responsiveness and speed were rigorously evaluated and compared against more conventional designs of the era, such as the Focke-Wulf FW-189 Uhu and the Arado R-198. The odds were stacked against the BV-141 with its unconventional single-engine design. Despite these apparent disadvantages, the prototypes excelled in every trial. However, on April 4, 1940, the Air Ministry concluded that while the plane mostly exceeded expectations, it still underperformed in critical areas. Despite this, the BV-141 showed promise as a reconnaissance plane. In 1939, Germany ordered 500 BV-141S. Although the engineers and designers were somewhat disappointed their intended bomber failed to meet expectations, they were grateful to receive a contract at all. By 1941, production was nearly ready to enter full swing. However, after 12 examples were produced, the German government decided the unique design of the BV-141 couldn't be manufactured as efficiently as more conventional aircraft. Instead, they relied on their substantial stock of the Focke-Wulf 189, which performed adequately. The 12 confirmed production aircraft featured more powerful BMW 801 engines, which were also urgently needed for the FW-190 fighter plane. This competition for resources may have contributed to the BV-141's cancellation. The fate of the BV-141 was sealed in the chaos of war. An Allied bombing raid obliterated the Focke-Wulf factory in Bremen, a crucial site producing the FW-200 Condor. This aircraft was one of Hitler's personal transports and was envisioned as a heavy bomber for the Soviet campaign. With their production redirected to the Condor, Blohm and Voss could do nothing to save the BV-141. As Allied forces overran Germany, soldiers stumbled upon the twisted wreckage of several BV-141S. British troops collected at least one and returned it to England for examination. Records in the Bibliography of Scientific and Industrial Reports suggest the U.S. Air Materiel Command may have acquired another for testing. Despite earlier beliefs, German production records revealed a total of 20 BV-141Bs had been produced, rather than the assumed 12. None of the BV-141 aircraft or its 38 planned variants saw combat. Their destiny confined them to test flights between 1939 and 1940. The initial plan to deploy them for reconnaissance on the Eastern Front never came to fruition. Today, not a single Blohm and Voss BV-141 survives. As the war in Europe concluded, Richard Vogt was swept to the United States as part of Operation Paperclip. His passion for unconventional aircraft designs thrived in this new environment. Vogt reportedly worked on designs for nuclear-powered bombers before joining Boeing as a civilian consultant. His legacy of innovation continued to influence aviation, extending far beyond the lifespan of the BV-141.